She cried and walked away just yesterday. And like a fool, I let her go. We had a silly fight the night before. I never said I love. I worked all day and then I got the call. Would you please come to see your wife? Something has happened and it's very grave. We cannot save the lady's life. And I never really told her just how much she meant to me. No, I never said goodbye. Now it's too late and she's just a memory. How can I go on? Now that girl is gone. Her perfume lingers all around me now. A pair of shoes lie on the floor. The bed unmade where just last night she lay. I cannot say I close the door. A shopping list of things she never buy, an apron lying on the chair. Is that her laugh I hear out in the hall? I turn and call, but she's not there. No, I never said goodbye, and I never how much she meant to me. No, I never said goodbye. Now it's too late and she's just a memory. How can I go on? Now that girl. Yesterday, and like a fool, I let her go. We had a silly fight the night before. I never said I love you so. I worked all day and then I got the call. Would you please come to see your wife? Something has happened and it's very grave. We cannot save the lady's life. No, I never said goodbye, and I never really told her just how much.
Come, we pray. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father, we are thankful for this day that thou hast granted unto us. Thou hast made it possible for us, Father, to enter your house. Father, this wasn't on our program for this year, for 2021. But Father, you knew the plan that you had for our dear sister. You know her by heart. And Father, because you knew her, you have called her home. And you have made it possible for us to gather here. If it wasn't so, Father, we would have been somewhere else. But you had made it possible for us to enter your house, to come and show our last respect. Father, please bless the family, bless the husband, bless the son and his children, and Father, also the brother and his family, and also those who know Auntie Irma, because they grew up together, they were friends, they were examples to one another, and Father, you have come into their midst, and you, the Browns family, their home, has found favor where you concerned, Father, because you have come, and you have come and visited them, and you took a loved one home. And Father, through this happening, you showed us again that you will always be in control of your work, because we are part of your work. We are your children. We are part of your plan of salvation. We know here on earth, we won't have a continuous city. Our turn will also come one day. And Father, how will we meet you? What will our representatives be, Father, when we have to leave this Mother Earth and present our soul unto you? What will you see in the soul that we will present to you, Father? Our soul that we carry comes from you, and our soul needs to return to you, Father. And we see to it that it doesn't return void unto you, because you make moments possible for us to have fellowship with you, to come into your house, to come and listen to your word. And through your word, Father, through the sacraments that you bestow upon us, you fashion and to mold us into your likeness, into your image. So one day will you, when you send your son to come and fetch us, we are no more strangers to one another, but we have allowed that your word fashion and mold us into your likeness. And this is what our dear sister did. Father, bless us now. You have prepared, a word has been prepared. Make it alive in and through us. And cover us under the prayers of our bearers of blessing. And if this will bring the fulfillment of your son, do not pass us by. Take us in your love and grace. I humbly plead this in Jesus' name. Amen. My dear bereaved family, dear mourners, dear loved ones, for this divine service, we have a word out of Jeremiah 29. I will read you the 11th verse. Jeremiah chapter 29. The 11th verse. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, said the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. In Afrikaans, Jeremiah 29, ons sal die 11th vers lees. Want ek weet wat gedagtes ek aangaande julle koester, spreek die Here. Gedagtes van vrede en nie van onheil nie, om julle 'n hoopvolle toekoms te gee, so ver. Julle kan sit.
Thank you.
family. Allow me to call you brothers and sisters. For some, maybe might be the first time that you enter our church. And Uncle Clarence, allow me to call you Uncle Clarence for this service, and Rodney as well. And also for the deceased, Auntie Irma. The soloist just sang, "Great is thy faithfulness." Dear family, dear mourners, dear brothers and sisters, we can all relate to that beautiful hymn of the faithfulness of our Heavenly Father. We are His children. He has brought us, He has called us, He has told us, because He knew us before we were born. We were part of His plan. We had parents that reared us. We had parents that taught us the life and the history of God, His Son Jesus, the sacrifices that He made on our behalf. And we made Jesus and God part of our life. And today, when we reflect on our life, when we look back, then we can also say, Lord, thank you for your faithfulness towards us as a family. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your help. Thank you for your assistance. Thank you for always being there for us. Because if we doesn't have the Lord who we serve in our life, if the Lord that we serve is not part of our journey, natural and also spiritual, what will our end be? What will our future be? Then, because here on earth, we won't have any continuity. Our time will also come when the Lord will come to come and take us home. And how is our meeting when we will one day meet our Lord? And through the promise which God has made, He said to the two people in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, and I will send someone that will bruise the head of the serpent because of sin. Sin separated us from the Lord. But God always remained faithful unto us. And because of His faithfulness, today we can also reflect back how the Lord made an impact in our walk of life, in our life, because on our journey, we also had to come across the Lord. On our journey, we also had interactions with the Lord. On our journey, there was also times that we have to call upon the Lord for help, for assistance, for guidance, for comfort, for help. And the Lord never fails us. And hence the hymn, "Great is thy faithfulness." And today when we can look back, then we can say, thank you, Lord, that you always stood by us. Thank you, Lord, that you were always there for us. Because when we had to go through a circumstance in life, we can always call on you. When we have a burden to carry or circumstances to face, we can always make our turn to you, because you will help, you will comfort, you will encourage, and you will grant us that strength. And that was the faithfulness, and this is the faithful God that we serve. Because God will also one day come and take us home, because He has a plan for us. As our text read, "For I know the thoughts that I have, I think towards you, said the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." And because the Lord made Himself known unto us, He gave us that spiritual future, that we know if we live here on earth, where we going to. Through His Son, the sacrifices that His Son made, He gave us a promise, "I will go and prepare a place for you. For where I am, you must also be." And that is the hope, that's the living hope that we need to keep alive. Because one day when God sent His Son to come and fetch us, that must be our future. That must be our spiritual future that we long to be. And what can we go and take with? Nothing. It's only the soul that belongs to the Lord that will go. And this body, we know it remains because of dust we were made. And of dust we will return back unto the earth. And because of this body, sometimes we place a lot of value to this body, but this body will also fail us, because through pains and aches and deterioration, where our age is concerned, this body will also fail us one day. But what did we do with the soul which the Lord has entrusted unto us? If we look in the mirror of our soul, today we can also ask ourselves, is the Lord still happy with the condition of my soul? Is the Lord still happy for what He see? My dear brothers and sisters, dear congregants, the Lord still grants us His grace. He grants us His love so that we can make that final adjustment still, So one day when we will need to meet up with the Lord, then it will please him to take us into that place which he has promised unto us. And this is what our dear sister did, Auntie Irma. She knew the Lord already because God told us, I knew you before you were born. And when we, our parents carried us, our mothers carried us, he knew about us because he placed his soul in us. And because of that soul germinate, that soul grow. And then on the day we were born, our parents, they were happy. And the same with Auntie Irma. She was happy. She made her parents happy because she was part of a set of twins. And because of that, the mother was so grateful unto the Lord that the Lord made it possible for her. And because of that great faith that she had, she didn't leave it there. She persevered. And because of that values which her parents instilled in her young life, she took it and she made it her own. And these were all the treasures that her parents gave unto her. Then she came in contact with the Lord when she had a younger age, and through her discipline and through her teaching and upbringing, she remained with the Lord. And the Lord gave her beautiful values. You will, when I read your butchery, then you will know what I'm talking about. And the values which the Lord has planted in her, the gifts. I read she made liquor food. She had baked biscuits, and I was told, if you knew Auntie Irma that well, and you ate of her coconut biscuits, well, that was the given. And who did she share it with? Later on, we will say, yeah, she shared it with the children. She cooked for them. And what did Jesus say? Suffer them not to come unto me, because unto such belongs the kingdom of God. The Lord already placed that beautiful values, that gifts within her at a young age. And what did she do? She made use of it. And what she shared with that which the Lord has installed in her soul. And then it says further, she showed the children respect. Rodney, I mean from Shetland, around this side, over Park Avenue until you got home. She gave you a hiding. What did she instill in your life? Discipline, respect, to honor. And today, this is a beautiful teaching and the gift which your mother has instilled and implanted into your life. And you, as a family tree, you can filter it down to your children too. And these were the gifts which the Lord has placed in your heart. Uncle Clarence, the two of you met. The Lord allows that beautiful bond from you when you met each other to germinate, to cultivate. And also, out of respect for her parents, the Lord allows you to ask them for a hand in marriage. And you look beautifully after her until the Lord called her home. And you, as you said on Sunday to me still, you still prepare the food. You still got everything ready. And when you said, love didn't start there already. Love was a journey. And because of your love towards her and the respect that you had, you see too that all these things were in place when she wakes up. But unfortunately, the Lord had other plans. He has other thoughts where your wife was concerned. And thankfully, you allow her to go through all these things, knowing that the Lord has an expected end where your wife is concerned. And today, my dear family, we are here. Hence, of the calling of our dear sister. The Lord knew her heart. The Lord knew the journey where he placed her on, because he knew her before she was born. And today, let us reflect on the life of our dear sister, Auntie Irma Carol Christina Brown. I will read to you her life history as it is here. Irma was born on the 23rd of March 1950 in Q-Town to God-fearing parents. She was one of three children, one of a set of identical twins, a twin sister named Erna and the younger brother Theo. The family lived in Q-Town, and she was baptized in the Moravian Church. She attended Q-Town Primary and later attended Alexander Sinton High School. During her youth, she had a keen interest in ballet and also played netball during her high school years. The family then moved from one house in Q-Town to another house in the same area. And as time went on, she met a young, handsome man living opposite them by the name of Clarence Brown. And that is where Clarence comes in. They became good friends, and they fell in love with each other. Later in their relationship, when things became serious, Parents ask her parents to get engaged to her, and 18 months later, the couple got the blessing to get married on the 4th of November, 1972, in the St. Mary's of the Angels Catholic Church. From this union, they were blessed with one son named Rodney. She worked at Lystra Zips 4 years, Optelin Zips for 3 years, and thereafter, she decided to stay at home to care for the family. Lucky Uncle Auntie Irma. In 1979, the couple moved to Westridge, Mitchell's Plain, where they still live today. Spiritual life and prayers was what kept this couple going. Friends and entertainment came second. And love was not a shortage in their relationship. The couple's motto was, falling in love is very easy, but stay in love is important in hard work. And through that, Uncle Clarence, the Lord will grant you much strength as from today onwards, because you were committed to the commitment that you made to her those days. And it wasn't easy, but you stood by the promise that you have made. And because through the years, you never allow entertainment, as you said, that was second nature. First the Lord, first Him, because you knew the blessings that is bound to when we promise the Lord something and we remain faithful unto that promise. And you did it until the day the Lord called your wife home. And how beautiful that your reunion would be one day when the Lord allows you and her to meet again. And then what, as our solo was saying, that faithfulness which you have committed unto her on the day of your marriage, that faithfulness the Lord will crown and the Lord will thank you, because what did the Lord say? If you do it unto the least of mine, you've done it unto me. And for that I say thank you to you, Uncle Clarence. We carry on. Irma was strong, willing, and an outspoken, God-fearing, but also joyful person, and always had a smile on her face. She was well-loved in her neighborhood and was one who would always help where she can. Even in her older days, she was willing to help out at the crèche to make food, as she had loved for the kids. To many of her friends, she was known as Auntie Poppy, and to some, Poppy. Because of that love that she had for the children, she thought of what Jesus said, suffer them not to come unto me. And what is a child that must go hungry? And you can help, you can assist, you can give. And this is a character which Auntie Irma shows. That is the love which she possessed, and in sharing, she also made them happy. She also filled their hearts and souls, and she also filled their stomach. Through her sacrifices, she made it possible. Where did that love generate? Where did it come from? It come from the Lord. And that is how the Lord works through us, that He shows we can reach out. And because of our reaching out and the sacrifices that we make, what will the Lord, look the other side when we do so? No. The Lord will tell His Father about it. Look at the heart of that sister, that daughter of mine. Look at that son of ours. Look at how the character come forth. And that is the nature which the Lord looks at today. And this was part of Auntie Irma's life. Then fond memories of the family. First Uncle Clarence. Irma could bake and make wonderful food. She knew exactly how to make food for me, and she knew exactly what I like and dislike. Irma used her own chocolates at Easter time, and this she would share with the elderly and kids. She was also known for her baking, and what was always the standout was the coconut biscuits, that what I spoke about, that she made, and the family, friends, and neighbors would always get a few biscuits, and this we will always remember of her. You could say it was a fan favorite. And I'm so sorry for myself that I never had the opportunity to taste that coconut biscuits. But with those who I came in contact, they said when there was, and there was the last one was left, then you could see how the eyes go. Who's going to get the last one? Because of that value and that passion that she put in that biscuit. Now we can reflect and see everything that she do, what was with love. Everything that she shared, she sacrificed to do it. Time, space was never a problem for her condition. She did it with love. And that is the character which our Heavenly Father wants us to portray. It reads as follows. She loves spending time with her family wherever, going out for the day to the beach or taking a drive or holiday. It was about being out and with family. What do they always say? A family that stays together, prays together. From a son, my mom was well known in the neighborhood as she wasn't shy to speak to anyone. And if you were out of line, she would tell you, no matter who you were. One time, she and my wife were coming from the shops, walking over the field, and was almost robbed by one of the guys. And one of the guys recognized her and said, no, we can't do this, as he knew her, and said, this is Mrs. Brown, we must leave her. And this is the extent of how everyone knew her. And that, how does people know you? How does people love you? It's about your character. First thing is about your character, as you are and what you portray. Somebody won't love you if you rude, foul language, and never greet. But you grow up to respect each other, and especially in the neighborhood. How will people know you? Because for who you are. And Auntie Irma stood for that. It says here, my mom was never one to shy away from giving hidings when I did something wrong, or if I was walking around and she didn't know where I was. When she found me one day, she gave me a hiding, the biggest hiding, from Shetland Close till to our house, from this side of the road until Rodney got home. But you learn out of that, isn't it, Rodney? And today it made you a strong person. And also you can reflect and you can still smile today of all the beautiful memories that you shared with your mother. And why did your mother give you that hiding? To keep you out of danger, to show you the way. And because of the motherly love, if it wasn't for that hiding today, what kind of gentleman would you betray today? But she gave you that teaching. And for that, even if it was painful on the day, today you can say, thank you, mother, for giving me that hiding. Because of that hiding, I'm a better person today. Because of that hiding, I can teach. And because of that hiding, through that hiding, you gave me what I am today. You made me what I am today. And it says here, when you come to bunking of school, because of that, what did we do when we bunk? We go and sit or walk around. But your mother always said, no, if you want to bunk, you come bunk here. Let your friends come. And when they come to your house, you were safe. You were sound. At least then she could give an account of your doings. And that was so beautiful. That was always the love of a mother. My mom was a huge Engelbert Humperdinck fan. We surprised her one day by taking her to a concert at Green Arena. When he came out onto the stage with girls around him, I remember her shouting, "Dies my man." And we can relate to that because we all had our fan favorite. And when a special song comes on the radio, we will even say, sometimes when Aidan Thomas plays something, say, "Janne, no vat my terug down memory lane." And that is how it was. And that is the way we grew up. We always had our fan favorite, and he was hers. And I say again, thank you for these beautiful moments that you and Uncle Clarence allowed to happen in the life of your mother because of that nature that she portrays. He says here from a brother, my sister means the world to me. Irma has done a lot for me and my family. She had a hand in arranging my daughter's 21st birthday. She was the one who helped with the wedding and also my daughter's Tanya 21st. All these events were of great success thanks to her and our family. And these are the moments that we will always cherish. My dear brothers and sisters, this great woman that lays here today, she was part of all this. And today the Lord took pleasure in taking her home. Why? Because she showed the virtues, the gifts which the Lord has invested in her. That was part of her life. And because she allowed that to be part of her life, it was easy for her to do what is expected. It was easy for her to share. It was easy for her to go the extra mile. It says here from the friend Adele, she was part of their wayless. And then she also blamed that the scale doesn't work because we are human. We will always blame the poor scale. And then she said, no, men, although you gave us all these classes, but there's something wrong with your scale, it's not us. But one day they were all caught out while they were finished, and then she, Adele, heard people laughing, and hey, I recognize that laugh, let me go and investigate. And then she saw, oh, but that is who jylle die skaal call. Jylle sê dis die skaal, but it's not the skaal, that is jylle wat achter die bak eet, soos hulle sê. And because of that, they became good friends, and they could interact, and that great respect that they had afterwards. She was then part of the team. She was then committed in what they had to do. And today we can all say, we also had one of those moments that we could also blame the scale. But then, somewhere a line had to be drawn, and she was willing to do so. And when she played her part, the results were shown. And it says further, although Auntie Irma also had a hearing problem, that never stopped her from doing good. That never interfered in her life, in her upbringing, to care, to share, and to go the extra mile. That impairedness never stopped her from doing good. It says here, Irma has always been God-fearing person. Growing up as a child, she attended the Moravian Church. Then, when she married, she attended with her husband and in the family Catholic Church. And much later in life, she decided to attend church with a neighbor, and then she started attending the New Apostolic Church. But that didn't stop her. Why did she allow the Lord to show her all these things? Because the Lord knew the plan that he had with her. She allowed the Lord to teach her soul. And for her, that was more important. Not the impairedness where it comes to the hearing, or not her age, but the maturity of the soul. And she allows the Lord to teach her where her soul is concerned, because that is the Lord's property. Our soul that we carry, that belongs to the Lord. And that must go back unto the Lord. And when she listened, then she came. She came. First, they said, she came on New Year's Eve. She invited a sister from Athlone, Erna, to go with her. And then from the New Year's Eve into the New Year, she ended off with the Lord, the year, and she wanted to start the new year with the Lord again. And that was her life. That was who Auntie Irma were. And then she attended our divine services and also had a desire to be adopted into our faith. And for that, my dear family, I must give thanks to you for allowing her to do so. You never stopped your wife when she also put her decision and desires before you, where her soul is concerned. Because we could encourage, we could help, but you never stood in the way. And for that, the Lord will give you an extra reward for allowing your wife where her soul is concerned. Because you want to have that beautiful relationship with the Lord. The same with you, Rodney. You allow your mother to come, and that was out of respect. And today, too, it's out of respect that we gather here today to say farewell to this beautiful soul. And when she came, she didn't want it just to come. She wanted to be part of this fellowship. She wanted to be part of this flock which the Lord prepares through his servants and through his teaching and through his speech, teaching. And then she was adopted on the 30th of June 2019 and sealed by our Apostle Peter Lambert on the 10th of November 2019. And this is where she first said, where that brother sits, she sits there, and afterwards when the choir moved from this side to that side, she sits where that couple sits, with the Van Wyk family. She wanted to be near the altar, and that was her desire. She didn't want it to miss out. And when she missed out on the word, what did she do? She goes around on a Monday to the family to inquire, what was the text about? What was the word about? Not to let the soul be short, cut, or loosed out. She always make provision to inquire. And then, as we have known, on Sunday morning the 30th, while Uncle Clarence said he was still busy preparing the food, and she to everything, and he was mindful, but the service is supposed to start at 9 o'clock. Why is the TV not on? And then when he made inquiries, then he realized the Lord has called her home in her sleep. What beautiful memories. We don't know what was her last encounter with the Lord. What was her pleading, her desire with the Lord. And in that stillness of the night, into the morning, the Lord called her soul home. And because the Lord called her soul home in her sleep, the Lord didn't even want her to be disturbed while the hustle and the bustle of the morning life. In her sleep, the Lord called her home. And that is the beauty, how the Lord works. That is His work. And now we can see the Lord will do that for us too. Why? Because He knows our plan. And because of these beautiful moments that we can reflect upon, my dear family, I thank you for allowing us to be part of the life of Auntie Irma. Because through her, we could also learn. She didn't worry about the aches and the pain. She wanted to be here. She was even, I can say, cross for COVID. Because COVID distanced us not from coming to the house of the Lord because of the numbers. Because she wanted to be here. And for that, and the sacrifices that she made, as we have read over the years, and the impact that she had on each and everyone's soul here, the Lord will grant you the blessings and the promise we will see each other again. And while we're reflecting on her life, I will ask for a musical piece. Auntie Irma is also survived by her husband, Uncle Clarence, son Rodney, it says here, the brother Theo, daughter-in-law Tracy, and her grandkids, Rodney Jr., Nathan, and Lulu. Yeah, to the bereaved family also, our sincere condolences in your time of bereavement. That the Lord always grant you strength, comfort in the knowing we will meet each other again. The parting might be in tears and in sadness today, but the reunion, the meeting will always be in joy, will always be in gladness, because the Lord has made it possible. But the Lord also grant us the word out of Jeremiah 29, verse 11. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, said the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil. God was never a God of evil. And because of these beautiful thoughts that he had, He thought about us too, not only about the Israelites at the time, no. God also thought about us in the end time. Who is going to prepare us for His coming? Who is preparing our soul for His return? He thought about us. And through thinking about us, He made it possible for us. He sent His Son. And His Son knew the plan of the Father. And because the Son knew the plan of the Father, when He was asked, Who sent you? He said, I did come to do the will of my Father. Beautiful war. He died for us on the cross. He suffered. He teaches. He leads. He guides. And above all, for those who He came in contact with, before He healed, He first said, and your sins are forgiven. And that was the great Father that we serve today. And because of all these things, the plan with the Lord and the thoughts which the Lord has for us, in the end time, He made it possible that His Son can be that example unto us. And His Son didn't leave it there and left it there. He also went through pain and suffering. And He died for us on the cross, for all of our sin, because He knew afar off, this is what's going to happen. But the victory of all victories is and was when He overcame death, That is where the Lord shows us. This eternal, this death is not eternal. This separation is not forever. He overcame death, and that will also be our portion. Because of the teaching which our soul received, and the teaching which the Lord gave unto us time and time again, when we gather in His house, or we have fellowship with Him, the Lord always reminds us, I go and prepare a place for you. So where I am, you must also be. That place which the Lord has promised unto us, let that place not be in vain. We see when constructions goes up, complexes are built, and there's no inhabitants. When you pass there again after a while, then you will see how in disarray that place looks. It first was beautiful, but now it's no more. And what does the Lord say about us? We are His people. We are the peculiar ones that He has chosen out of this world to make His to share His inheritance with us. And it's not everybody that wants to share inheritance here. If my father or mother had to leave me something and you come, I would say, but you're not part of my family. How can I share? But spiritually, the Lord through His Son has made that sacrifice for us. And He has paved the way that we can have that beautiful access to His Father. Today He's our advocate. If we fall or we fail, He pleads on our behalf where His Father is concerned. Because His Father is the righteous judge. His Father is the one that grants grace through His Son. His Father is the one that shows mercy. And when we fail the Lord, what do? We come in prayer before Him. And then we ask, Lord, please forgive me. Lord, please don't go in righteous judgment with me. Lord, please be there with me. I need to go through this. But Lord, You will grant me the strength to go through it. You will give me the comfort. And today, our Heavenly Father comfort you as a family. You might shed a tear. You might have sorrow today. But this is the thoughts which the Lord has where your mom is concerned, where your wife is concerned, Uncle Clarence. He knew her heart. And He knew the maturity of the soul. That's why the Lord called her home. And who could stop that? No one can. When the Lord wants to come and visit us at our homes and take a loved one home, who can stop that? The Lord loves the soul. And now we can see how important it is that we must look after our soul, that our soul never go lost. That is the promise which God made to Adam and Eve. I will send someone to bruise the head of the serpent. And through sending His Son paved that way for us. And He's today, as I said, He's our advocate. He will plead and plead on our behalf where the Lord is concerned. Let it always be so that we are mindful of our spiritual plan too, which the Lord has. Let the Lord's thoughts towards us also be of such a nature that through His thoughts and through His thinking, He will reveal Himself in His word, in the conversation that we have, and also He will make His plans known unto us so that we can also know what is our spiritual journey. As I said in the beginning, this journey here on earth will not be forever. We won't stay here forever. God will send His Son. And for that home which God has prepared for us, let us and let we prepare ourselves for that blessed occasion. If Auntie Irma could tell us today what she had to go through, dear brothers and sisters, then I think this will be her portion. It says here in 2 Timothy 4, verse 7 and 8, I have fought a good fight of faith. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. That is what she will say to us. She wouldn't love to come back anymore to be part of this earthly life where pain and suffering is concerned. This will be a portion. I fought a good fight of faith. I finished the race. I've kept the faith. And now she continues. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge will give to me on that day. And look what she says further. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved His appearing. These are the moments that await us also. She has finished her race. The Lord allows her to persevere for 71 years and 3 months. That was the journey which our Heavenly Father gave unto our dear sister Auntie Irma. And because of that life which the Lord allows her for 71 years and 3 months, that was the grace period which the Lord has allowed her to continue here on earth. She made full use of that time which the Lord has allowed her to experience. And through His love and grace, What did the Lord do? The Lord has called her unto him. And today, she's happy where she is. But it will not remain there. Tomorrow, our district apostle, he will invite all these souls in each and every Sunday, all these souls out of yonder realm, to experience word and sacrament. And she will always be in the divine service on a Sunday because of that invitation that is extended. And because of that beauty, the Lord still look after the soul in the beyond, because Satan doesn't have respect for us, nor for his word, nor for our soul. And Satan wants to infiltrate. And when Satan can rob the Lord and rob the soul which the Lord has placed in us from that which is expected of us, a crown of eternal life. And look, I will read you a text, how that place will look, which the Lord has gone to prepare. It says here in Revelation 21, verse 4, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, no sorrow, no crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. That is our portion, dear brothers and sisters. Remain faithful with the Lord. Let it always be so that the Lord is part of our spiritual life here on earth. And when we do so, then this will also be our portion. No more pain, no more suffering. The Lord's glory will always be our portion. Amen. Amen. To the family, all the best for you in the times that lies ahead. Always remember, Uncle Clarence, you have lost a good friend, a good companion who was always there. And one day she said, if it wasn't for my husband, I wouldn't have been here today. And as you have showed on Sunday, you still prepared everything for her, not for her to work so hard. Uncle Clarence, the Lord, if it was so that the Lord could give you a star today, you would have given so. But we know we cannot give. The Lord is the one that grants all these gifts. And these beautiful characters and moments that you have shared together, make that part and these beautiful memories, let it always be part of your life. And on the day of the Lord will always care for you. He said he will be a father to the fatherless and a mother to the motherless. And that is the care and the love which our Heavenly Father has for us. To you, Rodney, the values which your mother has instilled in your heart and soul, make full use of it. He allows your children to grow up. He allows you to, you allow your mom to see you married and also your family tree. And the values which he instilled in your life as husband and wife, and also where the children is concerned, you treasure that beautiful memories and values. And you work with that values. And on the day of the Lord, we will meet one another again. And to the brother Theo, also, these beautiful memories of your twin sisters now in the beyond with your parents, these are beautiful moments. No one can take that away. And on the day of the Lord, everything which we have to go through today, as a Bible promise, no more tears, no more sadness, no more death, that will be our portion. And when the Lord comes, we will be with him for time and all eternity. This is the way to go. This is how the Lord prepares us. He needs to come into our midst to take a loved one home so that we can be mindful that the Lord is always there for us. He's with us and he will be there for us also in the future. All the best as a family. Now I will commit the body to the earth. The congregation can rise. Now I return the mortal body to the earth with the words, earth to earth, dust to dust, ashes to ashes. Soul and spirit, however, I commend to the love of Jesus Christ, who shall guard over it until the resurrection of to eternal life. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of Jesus Christ and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Father, we are thankful for this few moments that which thou hast granted unto us. Together here in your house, to be part of this blessed fellowship, where we could say farewell to a sister, to a mother, to a wife, to a grandmother. And Father, you knew the plans and the thoughts that you had towards us is always of a good nature. And Father, you have a plan for us also spiritually. You have gone to prepare a place for us, which here you are, you also want us to be. But if this will bring the fulfillment of your son's thought during this day, please do not pass us by. Bless the family, be with them, and when they need and cry out to you, always listen to their cries and supplications and give them what they need and require. And Father, so doing, bless us further in this day and grant us what we need and require. I humbly plead this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. There will be, before the musical piece will now be rendered, you can sit, my dear congregants, and then Rodney will do a tribute on behalf of his mother. The wife will do so. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everybody. On behalf of our family, I'm doing the thanks. And there's one great thanks I need to do first. And I want to thank God Almighty for granting Mrs. Brown a life that she could get married, that she could start a family, and that she could see her grandchildren grow up. To everybody that hears testimony of her life, of the impact that you have on her life, the difference that you made, and the fact that you accepted her for who she was, and that was just Irma Brown. I want to thank this congregation for accepting her, for making her feel special, know that she needs her. I have never ever heard her in COVID saying that she misses to be in the church, and she has said that many times. I want to thank my family and our little family that we are, that no matter what differences we had, we always came back. And we were drawn back to her because that was the love that she emanated on us. I want to thank the doctors and the nurses that they always made her a priority when we pitched up at hospital with her. I want to thank her especially because when I get home with a baby, she's the first person to grab that baby and lie that baby down on a bed. She was selfless in her love. She has grown so tremendously in ways that I cannot say. She was a beautiful person. I just want to mention one little memory that I have of her. So Rodney used to play cricket on a Saturday and Mr. Brown used to do private catering. So she always used to tell me early in the morning, 8, 9 o'clock, Titi, trek jou aan, ons gaan lekker jack doen. So Saturdays used to be red Saturdays for her. So she would buy a six pack and she would sit with a six pack. So this afternoon I said to her, Mrs. Brown, jy het ons nou 3 gehad al, los my nou, gaan ons nou kos maak. Sy sê, wag, ek is nog nie klaar nie. So she pulls out the kitchen chair and there was this rack where the pots was on. En as ek wil dat ek liefst op die stoel stel en haar ek die pot af. So sê sy, oh, listen, that is kind of funny. So she got on this chair and she took off a big plastic pot and she fell and her arm broke. And I said, your arm is thick, I can't look your arm. She said, hey, can I look a sun in the camera? So I'm thinking, okay, fine, I have to put her arm on the cushion. And she said, sit by the night on my rug. Hoeveel reeds is oor? Meneer kan echt niet aan alle komen, ze zei nee, jij laat reeds haar, laat ik het kladderen, ik zal wachten tot ik niet kom. And I think that is a memory that plays in my mind all the time. I want to say thank you to my neighbors, to the Jordan family. They've been there ever since the Browns has moved in. They've been consistent in their lives. Up to Sunday they've been there for us, they are there for our children. I don't think we have people like that around anymore. Thank you so much, a heartfelt thank you. To the Van Wyk family, they've introduced her to something that she's never really known. And your introduction has landed her here today in your church. This was what she wanted, and this is what we have respected. And there is no greater honor than giving her off to you guys. Because she's going home, she is home, and that is what she wanted. I want to say thank you to Irma, because I used to call her Irma, Mrs. B, or Mama, or whatever came to mind, we just spoke the way we wanted to. She has changed in me so many things. She's accepted a little more. We brought her and she made Lulu her own. She's loved our children. She knows the ins and the outs better than we do. You can come on at night and she'll sit in the lounge. We don't have to say anything, she says. And that was the type of conversation we had. And the week before she passed, she used to come in every night. And she used to moan about a lot of things because it bothered her. But she said those things she needed to say. She was my greatest critic. Because if I looked funny in something, she would tell me, Jacob, was she sure and honey? Can pregnancy time is on. You're leaving a void in our home. You're leaving an empty space. That trouble won't find me. But your memory in our hearts will remain forever. And this family will move on. Because you have asked that of us. So thank you for making the difference in her life. Thank you for accepting her for the person that she was. Because right now she's looking down at us and she's saying, ik het moest jylle gesê, jylle gaan hy was ek doodgaan. So Rodney, Mr. Brown, the boys, Theo, Marina and Tanya, there was no greater love than Irma Brown. She has brought us back to know what the basic thing is, and that is family. And that no memory is too small or too big to be lost. So home is where Irma's home is. Let's give her what she wanted, and that was just peace. May you rest in peace, Irma. May you be happy where you are. I'm going to miss you. I'm going to miss the soup. I'm going to miss when I ask you for cauliflower food or cabbage food. You might tell me it's by your way, but you will cut that cabbage for us. And Rodney, your mother's words to me was, say for Rodney, ek sal altyd lief wees vir hom, en hy moet my boonste like, ek kan daar sy hering uit vir hom.
Yes, thank you very much to the undertakers too for redeeming this dignified service and for all the things that is present.
It's just the love that you show where Auntie Irma is concerned. Thank you for your presence here and also the support to the family. I will ask that the pallbearers come to the front, and while the cortege leave, there's two exits on the side. Because of COVID, those who sit on the side make use of the exits, the doors that side, and those who sit in the center will walk up with us as the cortege leave. There will be a musical item while we leave. I ask the pallbearers to come to the front, please.
Lord.